Hey everyone, I'm Martin. I want to introduce myself first. So I'm Martin Angelov. I'm from Bulgaria, which is this small country over there, if you haven't looked at it. My hometown is called Burgas, and it's on the coast of Black Sea. So if you don't have any plans for the summer, welcome. I work at Hacksoft, which is with these awesome guys. We are an outsourcing company, and we mainly write Django and React. We also organize a HackConf, which is a conference for programmers yearly, and taking place in the end of September. So if you have, if you want any other information, meet me outside. Also, I've just graduated as a software engineer in the last 2 weeks. So make some noise. Yeah. Thanks. Okay, let's dive in. Today, we are going to talk about testing in Python and Django. And the talk is mainly about unit testing since it's a beginner's talk. We're going to talk a little bit on Django substructure. And in the end, we're going to finish with some other testing methodologies. So before we start, I just want to know you a little bit better. So how many of you have written Django? Raise your hands. Whoa. Fair amount. And how many of you have written a unit test in Django? Cool. I can go out now. Okay, let's start with unit testing. What's unit testing? We have some principles and advantages in it. And the first one, of course, is that one test should test only one unit. All our unit tests should be easy to read and fast to execute and should be run in isolation. The main advantage about unit testing is that it helps us modify our business logic, and they serve as a documentation from developers to developers. Of course, it has some trade-offs, and the first, of course, is that one test should test only one unit, which sometimes is impossible, and I'll tell you why in a few more slides. Of course, when our project gets bigger, our test code becomes larger and it can be hard to maintain. I'm sure all of us have ever had a randomly failed test in CI, and that's why you can't push to production. And so, but the mocking, which is a main part of the unit test, to me this is a disadvantage because it may lead you in a regression and may cover some nasty bugs. The other problems of unit testing are the developers, because we are lazy, because we are developers, and we tend to break its principles, which is bad, and lead into non-exhaustive tests. Okay, talking about unit testing in Django's context, there is one main thing. Proper unit testing in Django is bounded up with proper Django structure. If our Django structure is bad, we can't actually unit test properly. Let me illustrate my thoughts with an example. Here is a simple invoice create view. We just create an invoice. When we get to the view, we just render a form. And when we submit a post request, we create an invoice. Pretty simple, right? Here is how the unit test for this view looks like. We have a setup. Then we test if we can access the view. And then we test if we actually create a new invoice and redirect after it. Okay, cool. But the main question here is this properly unit tested? Let's raise hands again. Who thinks this is properly unit tested? Okay. My bad. This one here. Is this properly unit tested?
It's a negative test case.
So if it's in the data. Yeah. Okay. Cool. The main problem here is that we have two assertions that's related to the HTTP response request cycle, and we actually test the status code of the response, right? And then we have a unit test that tests if an object is created in the database. Is there anything in common between these two things? Except the CRUD, I guess.
Your database is an external thing, so you're now not testing just that unit.
Yeah, that's the main thing. And the problem is that one unit does too many things, right? we have a view that's capable of the response request cycle and calling the ORM, which has nothing in common between them. And in the real world, actually, this example is pretty much more complicated because when you create an invoice in 2018, you don't just create an object in your database. You send emails, make some validations, call third parties, and so on and so on. And the problem here is, where should this logic live? And here comes the services concept. A colleague of mine, Rado, gave a talk about it a few hours ago. It was pretty awesome. I'll put a link to the slides if you haven't been there. So what's a service? A service is actually a function or object where you put all your heavy lifting business logic. And why you should do it? It's because it gives you reusability. You can use your services in APIs, in views, in other services, so on and so on. And the next pretty good thing is that it gives you a unit distinction. Let me show the next graphic. Now we have view, which just communicates with the HTTP response request. A client calls our view. The view on its side calls a service. And the service calls a Django ORM, calls task, calls other service, makes some validations, and so on and so on. This makes it looks like this unit, the service unit, actually do a lot of things. But if you look more abstractly, it's just our business logic. And now we can put the line between them and define actually a view unit and a service unit. The view unit is responsible for the HTTP response request cycle, taking the request, rendering a template, and calling a service. And the service on its side is responsible for actually heavy lifting logic. Here is how our service look like. This is pretty dumb example, but it makes the thing. We validate the amount, create an object, and kind of call a task, for example. This is our view now. It's pretty much the same because of the sake of the example, but we just, in the form valid, if you see, we just create, we call the service now. Now I can create an API view with really easily. Again, just calling the service and having a serialized response. That actually allows us to unit test properly now because we have distinguished between the unit. We can distinguish the units. Here is the invoice create view test. Now it just tests the response request, the response status codes. If you can access the view, can if it redirects, and if the service is called correctly by mocking it. Here is, for example, a test from the API view tests. It's pretty much the same, but I use the client from test plus test case. And here are the tests from the invoice service. Here, I don't have enough place on the slides over there in different sides, but the main point here is that we have distinguished the units. We now test if we create a new invoice, we test if we call the task by mocking it again, we test if a validation is not correct or validation error is raised, we test if we shouldn't create an invoice, right? We test it. Going away from the example, we should ask ourselves, what did we achieve? We just defined the units in our system, actually. Which gives us straightforward boundaries between these units. And this actually allows us to properly unit test them. And this actually gives us maintainability and modifiability in the system. That's the main point in having services. Since we have distinguished these units, we have now unit testing groups. For example, we have tests for views, APIs, services, models, utility functions, and maybe others. Or this is actually how our tests directory in the app looks like. Now I want to point out some common mistakes I do as a developer and I recently seen in my colleagues' work. The main problem about unit testing is that sometimes tests are non-exhaustive. And this is the biggest problem because Let's take a look to this example. We have a service that is used to a lot of place, in a lot of places in our system. One day, we decide to change its implementation. We check if it has unit tests. Yes, it does. Are they correct? They are. We run them, and everything is OK. We change the implementation, run again the test, and everything again is OK. The CI tells us that actually everything is working. We push to production, of course. And here is where the most nasty bugs come from, because we have a non-exhaustive unit test that didn't catch the bug that we introduced. And the problem here is that these bugs are usually caught by our users. The next common mistake that we do is to actually overtest or put too many asserts. For example, if you have the creating voice service tests and we have ten different test methods in it, we shouldn't put the assert true in voice is created every time. This actually breaks the principles. We tend to hard code values because it's just simple. You can sometimes it's just simple to hard code one, for example, if you need an integer or some random string. But it's bad. The more we get better in Django and in Python specifically, we tend to add too complicated logic in the tests. In my opinion, we had better have two inner force in the in a test method instead of putting some abstraction over it, because it's just easier to read. And when I go to the unit test, I see, okay, now I have two force, two loops, and it's just easier to read. The next bad thing is to have misleading test names and actually test something that is not in the test or not telling in the test. And messing up units or not mocking. As you may notice, I've mocked the validation service every time I test it in the service. And that's actually how you should do your unit tests. You should, if you don't mock the services or the utils that are caught inside your testing service component, this actually breaks the isolation principles. And the question is how to get along with these problems. The first thing is to keep up with the principles of unit testing. And this is how our project should be, how our work should go. The next thing is when you code review the code of your colleague, don't only review the parts of the code that he's written, also review its unit tests. That's the place where we actually code a lot of bugs. And again, unit tests should be simple. They should look like a documentation, in my opinion, so keep them simple. Now, let's talk a little bit about the tools we use. The first thing I want to mention is the test models, and the first thing is the unit test of Python. It's such an awesome model. It actually gives you everything you need to create the unit test you need. The main part of it is the mock model, which gives you the decorators, magic mock instances, and a lot more. And the second main part, in my opinion, is the test case object, from which you inherit, and it gives you the setup method, the teardown method, the all asserts you need. Another nice feature of test case model is the subtest context manager, which I really like, and we'll show you an example in the next slide. The next test model we use is the Django test. It doesn't give you a lot more, in my for example, but it's a nice wrapper around the test case, and the test case from Django test is actually the thing you should use if you want to communicate with the database. Another nice thing is that it gives you some nice shortcuts with the asserts, so you can easily assert your responses, for example. And the next thing we tend to use is the test plus model of Django. It's a side package, Django test plus, but it has a test case wrapper around the Django's test case. We really like it because it has such a nice API to use. Now let me show an example for the subtest context manager. Here is how two tests actually look like from the previous example. And with subtests, context manager, we actually can combine them and it can lower the code lines. Here is the how it looks like. It's pretty much the same. You just post and checks if the if you redirect and if you create a mock, if you code the service. Another nice thing is that it gives you these strings in the context manager as an argument, which can serve as documentation, as I tell. Something to note here, don't overdo with subtests, because this may lead into too long and hard to read tests. If you, for example, inner a subtest with a subtest in it and a subtest in it, you get three levels of going in, and to me it's just hard to read this. For factories, of course, we use Factory Boy. I think most of us do. It has such a nice integration with Django models, actually, the Django model factory. I think I want to mention here is the lazy attribute. This actually will create different values for the same test run of your object. For example, if you want two invoices in one test case, if you don't put the lazy attribute, both of the invoices will have the same amount. Another cool thing here is that it gives us a lot of customization, because if you want, for example, to use the create invoice service here, we can just predefine the dash create, underscore create method of the factory. For fake values, we use faker. Here is how we can customize its methods. You just give another provider, the so-called providers in it. For example, I want all my pyints to be positive, so I just change the faker pyint to my pyint provider. For test runner, we use pytest. We don't have enough time to tell all the features that PyTest give you. Go to the documentation, check it, but let me just, here is how most of the my test runs look like because of these arguments. The create dash dash create DB creates a new database and puts all your migration, runs all your migrations again. And if you use the dash dash reuse DB, the migrations won't start again. This actually really fastens the developer process. The dash dash LF stays for last failed, and it will run your last failed test. Another nice argument I've used is the dash dash duration, where you give an integer and it will give you the, for example, 10th most slow test you have. That's nice for monitoring, and also you can now use the PyTest markers that I won't mention now, but you can just put a marker in it over with the decorator. It's such an easy to use and well documented in the documentation. Mark the test as slow and don't run it every time in the CI. Now, I have a couple more minutes, so I want to go more further and talk a little bit more on some other testing methodologies. Okay, unit testing is awesome. We should do it a lot. But it has its limitations. When you go to the boundaries of unit testing, we should take a look and go with some other different testing methodologies. As a developer, I'm not really experienced with them. I'm not a QA guy. But recently we needed such tests in our project because it went quite big and we wanted to be sure that some crucial parts of the system are working. Well, the crucial parts of the system were actually bounded up with third-party calls. So we used some kind of a mixture of mixing end-to-end tests with validation testing. For those who don't know what's validation testing, it's actually testing methodology that verifies or validates the calls from your system with the third parties. Let me tell you the approach we took. We decided, as I said, to use end-to-end tests with validation testing, And one thing here is, if you, this approach works for you, it would be awesome. But if it doesn't, you and you decide to take something else, the first thing you want, you should ask yourself is, in what state is my project? In our case, the front end is now heavily developing, so it didn't really make sense to actually did the whole end-to-end test parts or create a visual regression test, because we will end up with deleting them because the design would be changed after a month, for example. What we did is to actually create a new project. We call them the client because it just calls our APIs. And its job is to, as I said, call our APIs. These APIs are, these APIs should call some third parties, and the client asserts that the response is from the third parties and everything is synced. That's pretty much everything it does. The thing that we need to do now is to put it in the CI because it's fully dockerized and easy to use. And I think that's pretty much everything I wanted to tell for today. So thank you. Some time for questions.
So if you have any questions, I'll ask you to come forward to and talk to the mic. So any questions about testing for Martin? Okay. So one question coming up.
Hello.
Hello.
I just like to come back to the different frameworks for testing, like the different libraries. So are you really using
testing?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, it's like unit test plus Django test plus PyTest inside one project, or how can you re-explain briefly what is better for what? Which one is better for working with a database and Django ORM, and which one is better for?
To me, Django test case, for example, the Django test case actually scales from simple test case and transaction test case. The transaction test case class is actually capable for all the ORM stuff. And I'm not 100% sure, but I think the test plus test case actually don't gives you any other abstraction over this. So it's the same, actually.
Okay. Thank you.
Hello, thanks for the great talk. So from what I understood, in order to have good unit tests, you need to have a really good project structure. Is that right?
100% in my opinion.
Yeah, so what if you don't have a good structure? How can you write good unit tests?
You can't, and that was the point of the talk, actually.
Okay, thanks.
So maybe a little follow-up question. You were talking about writing the unit tests each time for a single unit. So supposing this structure of a Django project where you go from the views on one side through API services models to the database, what would be the... Can you give some examples of the components that you're testing?
Say. Yeah, actually, what you saw there with the test of the views, if you have this structure, one nice thing is that all of your views tests would look something like this. If you have, we put our permissions and authentications usually in a mixin, so you can test if as an admin I can access this view or something like this, but it's pretty much everything. And when you have mocked the service call, that's the only thing, another thing that your test for the views should look like. Actually, the heavy lifting business logic is tested only in the service, and that's the main part. Again, here comes the problem that you mock every communication with the outside of the function. But this is how you should unit test. For anything else, just use end-to-end testing or some kind of integration, if that answers your question. Okay.
Okay, we have time for two more questions. If anyone has a question, please come forward. Okay, if there are no further questions, then thank you, Martin, for your talk.